everyone and welcome to St. Stephen's for this special occasion to give thanks and praise for Bob's life amongst us. And for those of you who might not be able to see, we do have a lovely picture of Bob here at the front. Welcome to his family who have joined us today to celebrate Bob's life and to commend him to God, giving thanks for all that he's been to us. And so we meet in the name of Jesus Christ, who died and was raised to the glory of God the Father. Grace, mercy, and peace be with you all. By day the Lord went ahead of them in a pillar of cloud to guide them on their way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light, so that they could travel by day or night. Those words from the book of Exodus will always remind me of Bob, not because of the cloud by day, but because of the pillar of fire by night. A pillar like a lighthouse. Lighthouses serve as markers along the way, protecting ships from dangerous shorelines and currents, and guiding ships at night with their bright lights. Also guiding ships in bad weather during the day with their horns. Now that we follow our routes electronically, we don't forget just how important these guiding lights were in their time. But Bob would have known that very well. Just as the Lord guided these people by staying solidly in front of them as a cloud, pillar or fire, so the lighthouse does its job by standing firm in the often cruel sea amongst the waves by just being there and remaining solid. Bob's faith was like that too. It reminds us that to be witnesses, to be lighthouses of faith, we just need to stand and shine and point the way. Bob did that quietly and effectively whilst he was with us, and today we remember with thanks his kindly and jovial presence among us, even when his knees were hurting, something that he never complained about. And we thank God that he's been guided by that eternal light to the safe and sound harbour of God's eternal rest. May Bob's long and eventful life be a witness to all of us of his faithfulness and kindness. And may we too put our trust in the one who leads us by day and by night on our journey towards the safe harbour of his heavenly kingdom. And so we look to the things that are, not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. But the things that are seen are transient. The things that are unseen are eternal. Today we come together to remember before God our brother Bob, to give thanks for his life, and to comfort one another in our sadness and grief. And so let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you because you made us in your own image, and gave us gifts in body, mind, and spirit. We thank you now for Bob, for what he meant to each of us. As we honour his memory, make us more aware that you are the one from whom comes every perfect gift, including the gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ. Amen. The family have chosen a couple of hymns or songs for us to sing. The first is All Things away. time to tear and a time to sow, a time to keep silence and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. What gain have the workers from their toil? I have seen the business that God has given to everyone to be busy with. He has made everything suitable for its time. Moreover, he has put a sense of past and future into their minds. Yet they cannot find out what God has done from the beginning to the end. I know that there is nothing better for them than to be happy and enjoy themselves as long as they live. Moreover, it is God's gift that all should eat and drink and take pleasure in all their toil. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And so some words about Bob's life. Robert Victor Foster was born on the 9th of August 1925 in Brentford, Ealing Maternity Hospital in Middlesex. He was the oldest of seven children. All the boys had names beginning with R: Richard, Roy, Robert and Richie. Reggie would have been the oldest, except he drowned in an unfortunate accident on the River Thames when Bob was only 10 days old. The three girls were Shirley and twins Joan and Liddy. Age three, the family moved to Portsmouth, living at number 50 Marylebone Street. As he grew up, Dad enjoyed the game of putting nails on the tram lines and seeing them cut in half. Situated between two ice cream factories and adjacent to the local slaughterhouse, Bob had lots of fun helping drive the cattle up the street, as well as pestering the ice cream sellers for a free ice cream. Bob's father was very strict. He worked as a bricklayer after having served in the First World War and survived the Battle of the Somme. He later served as a proud member of the Territorial Army. Bob's job was to shine all his buttons on his uniform and put his putties on for him correctly before accompanying his father to the drill hall. There he would have to sit quietly on a stool watching his father drill and shoot at targets. From the drill hall it was home to Sunday lunch, then Sunday school and church. On Saturdays his father used to watch Pompey and Portsmouth Football Club play when they were at home at Franklin Park. And after that he would take Bob to Charlotte Street Market to buy bargains sold off at the end of the day. When Dad was 10, their name came to the top of the council list and they moved to Sultan's Avenue in Milton. The move involved packing all the belongings onto a horse and cart, along with a handbarrow, and walking to the new three-bedroom house. Three boys in one room and three girls in the other. It was a bit cramped. To help the family income, the oldest boy, Bob had to get a paper out. His mum would get him up at 4 a.m. to go to the paper shop, collect a bike to Fratton Station and then collect the papers from the London train. He then went back to the shop, set up all the rounds for the other paper boys who started at 7 a.m. and do a paper round himself. He'd then go home, do any shopping his mother needed, and then run all the way to Milton Junior School, often arriving late. However, Bob really loved school. His favourite lessons were nature study, all about animals and plants. At home, he spent a lot of time helping to look after his brothers and sisters and took them with him when he went out and about to Milton Creek. Here they used to play pirates and pretend they were on Treasure Island, using the houseboats as props, pushing the pram with the twins on long walks along the Eastern Road, or going to the airport to watch the aeroplanes taking off and landing. Prior to September 1939, Bob's father had joined the RAF and the family moved to a village called Titchfield between Southampton and Fareham. When Bob was 14, where they lived in a small cottage at 79 West Hill. Bob went to the Navy recruiting office to try and join up, but because of his age, his parents would have had to give their permission. As she'd already lost Reggie years before, his mother told him that she didn't want any other sons to drown and tore up the papers. Bob decided to leave school at the tender age of 14 and he started a job in the local tannery. It was very hard work, but living in Tintagel was a happy time. He loved walking around the countryside, through the fields and woods, getting himself two dogs, Tripper and Poppet, as well as a Portage-gauge shotgun. These were the days when walking around the countryside with a shotgun was normal, and Bob was a good shot, regularly bringing home rabbits for dinner. He poached from the local woods with his friends. Apparently, the local policeman used to chase them. He knew where they were, but would look the other way if there was something left on his doorstep from time to time. Bob used to leave a rabbit, pheasant, or even a salmon when they were running past his back door. Policemen would occasionally catch them to give them a clip around the ear, just to keep them in check. The 16 Bob left home and went to London, where he had a lot of different jobs before he was old enough to join the army, where he served in logistics, driving all sorts of army trucks all over England. On the 7th of June 1944, D-Day plus one, he drove an amphibious truck onto Sword Beach as part of the Normandy landings and continued to drive and supply frontline troops with the push through to Berlin in April 1945. As with many of the veterans, Bob never really spoke about his time in the war, and we only found out that he'd been at the D-Day landings when the boys were around 9 and 10. We went to see a commemoration event in Portsmouth, and Bob casually mentioned his involvement in the war. They were perhaps memories he didn't want to dig up. After being demobbed, Bob had a series of jobs in Liverpool and London, working for some time at Peter Jones in Oxford Street. He then applied to Trinity House to be a lighthouse keeper, which proved to be one of his favourite jobs. It indulged his love of the sea, and he liked moving from one lighthouse to another, serving in 12 different lighthouses around the southern British Isles, including Beachy Head, Portland Bell, Edisto, Anvil Point, as well as lighthouses on the Channel Islands at Alderney and Sark. The land housekeeper's job was primarily to maintain the operation of the land. Additionally, the keepers would send Morse code, semaphore and radio messages regarding shipping and weather situations. Hourly observations were made of cloud formations and weather fronts. And prior to satellites, this was the information used by the Met Office for weather and shipping forecasts. Whilst on shore leave in Portsmouth and attending a local dance, Bob met May White from Wolverhampton, who was on holiday with two friends. And after a postal romance, they were married in 1957 and settled in Portsmouth. Bob and May started a family and had two daughters, Julie and Jan. After more than 20 years in Trinity House, Bob decided to leave so he could spend more time with the family, and he joined the GPO as a postman, enjoying the daily 13-mile postal rounds. Coming on shore allowed him time to pursue all of his many interests, including hobbies, reading rabbits, cycling, painting, lino printing, and many more. After 2 years of nursing his wife May before she passed away in 2011 from Alzheimer's, Bob continued to live in Portsmouth until he was himself taken to hospital and told he couldn't really live on his own anymore. That was when he came to live with his daughter Julie and her family in Canterbury. Bob soon joined St Stephen's Church as a regular member, particularly enjoying holding court with all the ladies in the Acorn Cafe. He also enjoyed playing whist at the community centre every Wednesday evening. It was a chance to catch up with other friends, and he often enjoyed winning hands and bringing home the game and raffle prizes he won. He continued painting and joined the Blean Art Society, which encouraged him to exhibit his paintings for the first time. The pandemic did curtail many of Bob's activities, but he continued to read voraciously, complete jigsaw puzzles, and enjoy colouring and collating his vast postcard collection. The stay in hospital just before Christmas for a series of blood transfusions unfortunately exposed him to COVID. He was at home when he died, very peacefully, with his Julie holding his hand on December the 18th, 2021. It wasn't before enjoying his favourite meal the night before and a film that he thought had a perfect ending. As he led his life, Bob left it with no complaint and little fuss. And so we thank God for this wonderful life that's been shared with us. And we offer Bob to God, giving thanks. The choir are going to sing that great hymn of the sea, Eternal Father, Strong to Save.
It's astonishing and marvellous and wonderful to see so many people here today. Thank you for coming. After that sea-inspired song, I'm going to read out a poem by Marjorie Wilson called The Lighthouse. Burning upon some hidden shore across the sea one night, a little reef, the captain said, we saw a shiny light. He said there was a lighthouse there, where, lonely in the sea, men moved to guard that blooming light and trim the lamp for me. For me, for him, for every ship that passes by that way, I thought it must be strange and quiet to be there every day. They have no shops, no fields, no streets, no whispering sound of trees, but always shouting at their feet the great voice of the sea. And when we sleep at night, they wake, and over every wave, they send that straight, strong arm of light stretched like a rope to save.
My dad was a one-off. Not many daughters could say their father was a lighthouse keeper and then a postman. He was also a man with a thousand hobbies, from painting, model boat building, stone polishing, jewellery making to photography. You name it, he'd had a go at it. He was also a keen cyclist, and when he retired, he cycled throughout southern England, staying at youth hostels and sending Julie and I numerous postcards from a variety of locations. For a man with little formal education, he was very knowledgeable about a vast number of subjects and could converse to anyone about lots of different things. This made him a very sociable man to be around, hence so many friends are here today. Thank you for coming. He instilled in me a love of books, taking Julie and I to the library on a regular basis to collect the pile of books. I still read a book a week, and I have 7 well-stocked bookcases in my house today. I would rather give away clothes and shoes, but no books. My father was far older than any of my friend's parents, but he always did more for me, more with me than any other parent, despite working very long hours. It did not take me long to work out that my dad was at least 100 times more fun and interesting and clever than any other parents I saw. We had the best of times together, collecting cockles at Leon Solent, camping in Dorset, Devon and Cornwall. He took me out fossilling on numerous occasions, something I still do today and have a very large collection. We took numerous trips out on his Honda motorbike, even as far as Wales. My bum has never been as numb since. Our school holidays were spent on trips to heritage sites, castles, stately homes, gardens, museums and zoos. It was such an education. Hence, I ended up studying geography history and I am now a trained field archaeologist. My father was such an influence on my life. And wherever we went, my father took photographs, which had proved to be a great record of our fun times together and my very happy childhood. He very happily spent hours reading, scrapbooking and watching old films on TV. Thanks to my dad, I've seen every cowboy and World War film ever made. His favourite being John Wayne films and action war films. I must have seen The Dumb Busters, The Eagle Has Landed, The Guns of Navarone and Run Silent, Run Deep at least 5 times. It still makes me smile when I see an old film that was one of Dad's favourites on TV. But my dad taught me so much more than the appreciation of history, art, literature, nature and old movies. He taught me to never let people say I could not do anything because I was female, to always stand up for what I believed in, to think about others who were less fortunate than myself, to give rather than receive, and to always appreciate what we had rather than what we think we need. And now as I approach 60, I see how I've benefited from all that advice. I love my dad. My dad was a great father, and I'm my father's daughter.
I should have gone first, I think. My main recollections of Dad from my childhood. My main recollections of Dad from my childhood are about him going away to the lighthouse, being away a lot, and then the lovely times when he came home on leave. When he was awake, Mum would take me and Jan to the seafront on a clear day, and we would wave to him on the Nab Tower. Although it was too far for him to see us, it always brought us a little closer. When Dad came home on leave, he would sometimes come to meet me from school in his Trinity House uniform. It was very smart, and I remember being very proud of him. I missed him a lot. Once in an attempt to get Dad to return home early, I got into a lot of trouble by hiding the keys to his shed where he housed his prized dahlias. I thought he would have to return to find the key and then to water them. However, Mum got the man next door to dig up the drains and they found the key and he didn't have to come home. Dahlias was only one of Dad's many and varied interests, as Jan has talked about. He pursued them throughout his long life. I don't know if there is an entry in the Guinness Book of Records for the most hobbies taken up in a lifetime. If there is one, I'm sure Dad would get an honourable mention. Whilst on the lighthouse, he developed his lifelong interest in weather forecasting and cloud watching. The lighthouse has been the main source of long-range weather forecasting for satellites. Most recently, on my daily walks, I've developed a love of taking nature pictures with my phone. My favourite shots were skies and cloud formations, and I've just realised that somehow I've inherited my dad's interest in weather forecasting. After Dad left Trinity House and became a postman, he certainly had more time to develop further hobbies. Dad's hobbies were always a major part of our family life, and we all got involved. For many years, Dad bred rabbits for show, and at some point we had up to 50 rabbits in our garden, all housed in cages that had been built by my dad. Jan and I were there getting the screwdrivers and holding the end of the woods as he screwed them all together. Dad loved to turn his hand to anything that could be made out of wood, especially if it had been salvaged from skips in the area. Dad always collected bits of wood that might come in handy. Even during his walks along the footpath here, he would often come back with a piece of wood that he found. When we cleared out the family home in Portsmouth, there was certainly more than a few trees worth of wood secreted around the property, just in case it could come in handy. Another inheritance I probably gained from him is my manic desire to recycle, and I think Dad would be proud of all the things we've managed to recycle through our household. We all attended the rabbit shows, travelling around the country with rabbits in the car in cages. Dad won many prizes, including several best in shows for his veterans. Mine and Jan's job was to hold the rabbits on the judges' table while they were being marked and to collect the competitors' entries from the different cages around the exhibition hall, which kept us very busy. Cycling was another passion that I was able to share with Dad. He won many medals for cycling 100 miles on his own, but twice we completed the 60-mile London to Brighton ride together in 1981 and 1982. The bicycling certainly kept him fit, along with all the walking as he did as a postman. And every summer, as Jan said, he was on cycling holidays, staying in youth hostels, and sending us lovely postcards of where he had been. He then progressed to a Honda motorcycle and travelled around the country, adding a sidecar so that Mum could accompany him. He went to the Isle of Man to watch the TT races, as well as riding the course, just to see how difficult it was. Aged 62, he took up painting and completed his GCSE in art, enjoying the opportunity of attending college, which had been denied to him in his earlier years. Painting became a real passion, with one whole room in the house being dedicated to his studio. He enjoyed many painting holidays on the Isle of Wight with groups of international and like-minded artists, many of whom he corresponded with on a regular basis for many years. He particularly enjoyed painting old buildings, and over time got to grips with the difficulties of perspective and produced some lovely paintings. Some of these are on display in the hall where we're going to have the refreshments afterwards. And we'd really like to offer the opportunity, if you see one that you like, to take it home with you to remember Dad. Mum and Dad lived happily for more than 50 years at 39 Bramble Road in Portsmouth. They bought the house as a convenient location for Dad to travel to and from the lighthouses along the south coast where he worked. Over the years, Dad delighted in painting and decorating this house and was given free rein by Mum for his love of bright colours, with some very psychedelic wallpapers and equally, to my eye, clashing paintwork. Mum was always a great supporter of Dad's interests throughout their long marriage, and I have very vivid memories of helping my mum feed all the 50 rabbits in the winter with hot vegetable mash when Dad was working late. When Mum fell ill and broke her leg aged 90 and her Alzheimer's suddenly became much worse, she was confined to a bed in the downstairs lounge, but Dad immediately took up looking after her, attending to her every need. And despite this confining him to the house almost completely, he never complained, and nothing was too much for his beloved May. After 2 years at home, Mum passed away, and Dad had to get used to living on his own again. Although he missed Mum greatly, he had always been happy in his own company, and his hobbies were very helpful in filling his days. 9 years ago, Dad came to live with us in Canterbury, and was delighted to play a bigger part in family life with Julian and Sammy, his two grandsons. Here, he continued to paint and joined the Bleed Art Society, where he was encouraged to have his first exhibition of work in Canterbury. He enjoyed meeting fellow artists, and the talks on techniques expanded his talent, and the house was filled with his art. Dad soon became well known in this neighbourhood throughout his daily walks to the shop and to buy his paper. He would chat to everyone he met along the way, getting to know many of the school children and their parents and carers. He made good friends here at St Stephen's Church and always looked forward to Wednesday mornings at the Acorn Cafe, where he enjoyed lots of lovely cakes and laughter with the other members. The whist group at the community centre was always a fun event for Dad, where he was a regular player, enjoying the company and friendship of the other members, many of whom are here today. He was always delighted when I collected him on a Wednesday evening to recount the hands he had won, or how he just missed on a prize by a cut of a card. We also enjoyed many packets of biscuits, sweets and tins of fruits from his winnings. Once a month, Dad would also accompany Richard and Angela to the open mic night at a pub in Westmere, where he especially enjoyed any performances that involved country and western music, which was his favourite. I have fond memories of him listening to his favourite tracks in the living room of our house and his attempts to sing along with them. Dad supported Angela's card making to raise funds for Alzheimer's research by manning the card table at the annual garden event she held in her lovely house. He encouraged visitors to buy cards for the good cause and participated in lively conversations. He also made Christmas decorations for the same cause and for many other causes that I put in front of him. And in the months leading up to Christmas, he always started in August. He was sticking together and cutting out old Christmas cards to make what became known as Bob's Balls. Dad was an avid reader, as Jan has said, and could easily read a book in a day. It was a constant job to search the charity shops for the different genres that he liked: history, nature, crime, and autobiographies. The thicker the book, the better. It was always a triumph for me to arrive home from a charity shop with a whole series that he would like and give it to him because it gave him such pleasure. I will miss browsing the charity shops, although Richard has recently taken up reading, so I have resumed my mission. As he got older and less mobile, Dad rarely complained, but just did what he could to get the best out of every day. As painting became more difficult, he changed to colouring books with very intricate designs, which he completed in his usual eye-popping bright colour schemes. Together we completed many jigsaws, and Julian often helped out with the skies when they became too much for us. Dad was always up to date with the news and current affairs and didn't hold back in his opinion of the government of the day. We are always reminded of Dad's interest in the weather when we see the daily forecast or catch up on the shipping forecast on the radio. Dad, as Jan said, enjoyed watching films, but only if they had either a happy ending or what he considered a suitable one. We continue to use the Grandad test in films we have seen since he died. Would Grandad have approved of this one? Dad lived a long life, and when you look back, it was a good and happy one. We miss him sitting in his usual seat, and it has been hard for us to watch the Euro football tournament and Tour de France without Dad's usual comments of poor penalties and well done Cavendish. As I was going through Dad's books, I found this paragraph that he'd recently copied out onto a slip of paper. It seems a fitting and significant statement, or one that he chose for himself at the end as he approached his time to prepare to join his beloved May. Go now to your dwelling place, to enter into your days of your togetherness, and may your days be good and long upon the earth, just like Dad's were. And as it was said to you all, cheerio.
To everyone, young and old, he was known simply as Bob. Thank you, Julian Richard, for looking after him and enabling him to come into our community and shed his light upon us. He was surely one of the most widely known residents hereabouts. His warmth and kindness touched many lives. He gave me the precious gift of laughter on a daily basis and enriched my mind with stories of his long and interesting life. His wit and banter were a joy to me. His family gave him the opportunity to pursue his lifelong interest in hobbies and pastimes, which served him well to the end, enabling him to keep his mind active and up to date with local and world affairs. You fed not only his mind, but also his body, giving him the anticipation of lovely meals, a cause very dear to Bob's heart. In common with many, I can't help but celebrate his long and interesting life, crowned by his last years in the loving care of his family. But Bob served a very important role for me, in that if I ever started to feel the weight of my 73 years, I could always think of the lovely gentleman up the road who was 22 years older than me and learn from it.
I'm just going to read some words out on behalf of my brother first. So, dear Grandad, I always miss you sitting on your chair. You were always there when I came home from school, from holiday, or just having been out for the day. Thank you for always greeting me with a big smile and a hug. I will miss watching the Antiques Roadshow with my favourite lady, Fiona Bruce. Evaluation, I'll miss you always thinking something is worth £100 rather than its actual valuation of over £10,000. I will miss you telling me the places I've visited, how they used to be in your time. This was usually followed by the explanation that it was either all rubble when I was there, or it was a bit of a dump. Or you would point to a housing estate and remark, it used to all be fields there. I will forever miss the way you eat with your TV headphones on, chewing so loud the rest of us could hardly hear the TV. You certainly enjoyed your food. Thank you for showing me what real love and commitment is when you looked after Grandma for so long, always being by her side no matter what. I will always treasure the time we had together. Thank you for being my granddad. Me, my family, and all my friends miss you. And then some of my own words. The last piece of advice I received from my granddad was to live a good life, which is about as good an answer as I could ever get from him. For instance, when I asked him about gravity, he told me it's what keeps him on the ground. I then asked if he wanted to know any more about gravity, to which he said, no, that's all I need to know. When I asked about what he wanted to do when he was younger, he mentioned that he wanted to be a postman in Australia, and that's not a mailman. That's someone that goes out into the wilderness with his dog and his horse for about a month at a time to repair fence posts. I thought he must have lost the plot to want to be isolated that much, but I think he just really enjoyed his own company. I'm very thankful that he went dancing one night and happened upon my grandma. When I was younger, I remember him taking me to the cinema to watch Spider-Man 2. And during the 9 great years he lived with us, we shared a common love for Studio Ghibli films. I made sure he watched every single one that was ever made. And Porco Rosso was his favourite one because of the seaplanes. He was a great granddad with a mysterious house filled with so many things, I'm sure you must have forgotten about half of them. He was filled with a couple of war stories that would occasionally fall out when you mentioned the right thing. I've been to Holland too, just all the cities were flat when I was there. Or how he dropped a tank off of his truck that one time. He truly was one of a kind, and I will cherish the time we spent with him forever.
Joy to be with, he was, I would describe him as a real gentleman. He just had so much in him to give and so much to say. Unfortunately, he was very kind to my wife, and she can't be here today because she just had a small operation. But what she's done is asked me if I could read a few words on her behalf. And it's written as a sort of letter. Dear Bob, it's been a year since I last saw you. You were sitting in your usual place by the window when Keith and I visited Sammy and Ashley to give them a card and a present for their wedding. When we were leaving, I hesitated to give you a hug. Julie said it was okay, but you said no because of COVID. When we were all together at Hever Place, both Julian and Sammy quite often said, Grandad would still be standing after we've all gone. We laughed and smiled about it, but for some reason I started to believe it. Silly me, I really believed it. I often wonder how you've been there in that special place in heaven. Did you enjoy Wimbledon with your wife, May? How many books have you read? How many paintings have you done so far up there? Actually, I still kind of believe that you're still. I believe you are settled where you are and already have lovely people for company. I wish you could have given me a hug one more time, but I'm going to be patient and I'll wait for one until I see you again. I miss you so much. You were special. Lots of love, Yasuko.
The hymn there, How Great Thou Art.
Thank you.
Father in heaven, we give you thanks today for your Son of God. We praise you as we recollect his life and cherish his memory. Bless you that in bearing your image, he has brought life, light into our lives. For we have seen in his friendship reflections of your compassion, in his integrity demonstrations of your goodness, in his faithfulness glimpses of your eternal love. Grant to each of us, beloved and bereft, the grace to follow his good example, so that we with him may come to your everlasting kingdom, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who died and rose again and opened the gate of glory, to whom be praise for all eternity. Amen. And now the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, make him perfect in every good work to do his will. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
West Virginia, Blue Ridge Mountains, Shenandoah River. Life is old there, older than the trees, younger than the mountains, growing like a breeze. Country roads, take me home to the place. Teardrop in my eye, country roads, take me home to the place. Country roads.